Amen. Well, we are thrilled this morning to be in Romans 14. If you would turn with me there, please, Romans 14. You will also need 1 Corinthians 3. Romans 14 and 1 Corinthians 3. As you turn to Romans 14, I just want to make note, hopefully every one of you got a bulletin. If you didn't, grab one on the way out, because there's a little devotional reading in there that I won't reference it today, but it does tie in with our teaching. But there's also an outline of Romans 12 and 13 for you. Again, true to form, once I finish teaching the passage, I go ahead and make the outline and get it out to you. So now it is there for those that are watching over the internet. That outline, if it's not already, it will be available in a PDF form under the Romans headings of teachings as well. Quite nice to see as I look at the internet usage, there's quite a few people following along with us in the book of Romans. A few less on YouTube these days, because we're pushing stuff to Facebook and through the Facebook page, but also people hitting the MP3s on the website, and so that is great as well. So that outline is available there for you. And we will be, of course, starting chapter 14 today in the book of Romans, and we'll be cross-referencing to 1 Corinthians 3. We'll be using some other scriptures, which you're welcome to look at, but those that's one that I'm wanting you to see this morning. So this morning we'll be looking at the first 13 verses of Romans 14. The chapter divides nicely in half, and so we'll take the first half this morning, and Lord willing, look at taking the next half next Sunday. So let's read down through the first 13 verses so we're all on the same page of Romans 14. Paul writes, Romans 14, verse 1, "Receive one who is weak in the faith, but not to disputes over doubtful things. For one believes he may eat all things, but he who is weak eats only vegetables. Let not him who eats despise him who does not eat, and let not him who does not eat judge him who eats, for God has received him. Who are you to judge another's servant? To his own master he stands or falls. Indeed, he will be made to stand, for God is able to make him stand. One person esteems one day above another. Another esteems every day alike. Let each be fully convinced in his own mind. He who observes the day observes it to the Lord, and he who does not observe the day to the Lord, he does not observe it. And he who eats, eats to the Lord, for he gives God thanks. And he who does not eat, to the Lord he does not eat, and gives God thanks. For none of us lives to himself. No one dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and rose and lived again, that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. But why do you judge your brother? Or why do you show contempt for your brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then each of us shall give account of himself to God. Therefore, let us not judge one another any more, but rather resolve this, not to put a stumbling block or a cause to fall in our brother's way." Making our way through the book of Romans, the book dividing up into three sections, we have found ourselves, since Romans chapter 12, verse 1, we found ourselves in the third section of the book of Romans, that section that makes practical application of all that we have learned so far. And the first eight chapters talking about the principles of the gospel of God. And in Romans 12 and following, we're learning how those principles are applied. And you can take a look if you want, but all of this is building off the foundation of Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. "I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service." So everything that we've looked at since Romans 12, 1 is building off of and only works when we are living our lives as living sacrifices before the Lord. So that affects our personal walk, we've seen. It affects our walk with others. And it affects our walk with Jesus. That's where we spent our time in the last couple weeks. So our personal walk, our walk with others, our walk with Jesus, but sometimes there are complications, there are difficulties, there are trials, there are challenges, and frequently all of that comes through other people, other Christians. Let me give you just a sampling. Paul wrote to the church at Corinth, and he said this, Corinthian Christians, I plead with you by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ that you all speak the same thing and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. For it has been declared to me concerning you, my brethren, by those of Chloe's household, that there are contentions among you Christians. Now, I say that each of you says, I'm of Paul, I'm of Apollos, or I'm of Cephas, or I'm of Christ. There was conflict amongst the Christians in the church at Corinth. But not only there, Paul wrote to the churches in Galatia, Galatians 5:13, for you, brethren, have been called to liberty. Only do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word. Even in this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, beware lest you be consumed by one another. Paul writing to the Christians in the churches of Galatia. Oh, so too the church at Ephesus. Ephesians 4, Paul would write, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, I beseech you, I beg of you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. You Ephesian Christians, please. And so too the church at Philippi. Philippians chapter 4, verse 2, Paul writes specifically, I implore Euodia, and I implore Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Stop fighting with each other. If we're going to be living sacrifices, it's going to affect our personal walk with the Lord. It's going to affect our walk with others, both those in the church and out in the world. Of course, it is going to have an impact on our walk with Jesus. But it also needs to have an impact upon us as we move in and out of the fellowship of faith, the church, the body of Christ. Warren Wiersbe would say this, speaking of those challenges found in the early church. He says, unfortunately, we have similar problems today with many gray areas of life that are not clearly right or wrong to every believer. Oh my goodness, the things that we can fight over as Christians that have nothing to do with the Bible, that are not spoken about in the Bible in any way. He continues, he says, some activities we know are wrong because the Bible clearly condemns them. Other activities we know are right because the Bible clearly commands them. But when it comes to areas that are not clearly defined in Scripture, we find ourselves needing some sort of guidance. And here in Romans 14, Paul gives principles of this guidance. He explains how believers can disagree on non-essentials and still maintain unity in the church. Unity in the church is important. It would be the psalmist who would write in Psalm 133, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. You ever been on the outs with somebody in the church body here? I hope not, but I bet there's some in this room that have. And week after week, you show up after praise and worship starts. We're already worshiping and honoring and glorifying the Lord, but you come in 10 minutes late because you want to know where that other person is sitting so you can sit as far away from them as possible. Or if there's an event and they've signed up for it, you see their name on the sign-up list, you don't come because you don't want to have any type of intimate fellowship with that individual. No, it's good and it's pleasant for brethren to dwell together in unity. It's like the precious oil upon the head, the psalmist states, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the edges of his garment. It's like the dew of Hermon descending upon the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord commanded the blessing, life forevermore. See, when we're in fellowship with each other, when we're in unity with each other, it's a taste of heaven. It's a taste of life forevermore. If you're born again by the Spirit of God and you're here this morning, you know what? We are going to spend all eternity together in our glorified bodies. How wonderful is that going to be? And when we function together, when we accept each other, when we love each other, and when we give liberty in the areas of non-essentials, our unity grows stronger in our enjoyment and our time spent with each other. 1 Corinthians 12, Paul would write, if the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole body were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them in the body, just as he pleased. We spent a lot of time talking about the body of Christ. God has placed each of us in the body right where he wants us to be. And we're to function in that location, in that place that he has put us. So check this out. If you're taking notes, I do have an outline for this morning because I want to take these 13 verses and I want us to be able to handle them and have an understanding for them. Of course, we've already seen our personal walk, living sacrifice, and our personal walk, our walk with others, our walk with Jesus. And now today, as to our walk with other Christians, the first 13 verses of Romans 14, the heading on your outline should say, as to our walk with other Christians. These first 13 verses, they deal with be relating in liberty. We are to be relating in liberty to each other. Be relating in liberty. There are three sections to the teaching this morning. I'll give all three of them to you here at the beginning. Number one, we all are servants of God. That's verses 1-4. We all are servants of God. Number two, we all belong to the Lord. That's verses 5-9. We all belong to the Lord. And third and finally, we all are not to judge. We all are not to judge. That's verses 10-13. So, chapter 14, the heading is as to our walk with other Christians. The first 13 verses deal with our relating to each other in liberty. And there are three aspects to that. We all are servants of God. We all belong to the Lord. We all are not to judge. Now, to kick us off and kind of get us going into the text a little bit, before we talk about the text specifically, let me read to you, and I'm going to do this a couple of times during the teaching, but let me just read to you the writing of a man by the name of Leslie Flynn, who speaks about some of these differences in the church on kind of like a worldwide basis. I thought this was pretty cool. He writes, "Why disagreements exist today in our churches over certain practices? A Christian from the South may be repelled by a swimming party for both men and women, then offend his northern brethren by lighting up a cigarette. At an international gathering for missionaries, a woman from the Orient could not wear sandals with a clear conscience. A Christian from Western Canada thought it worldly for a Christian acquaintance to wear a wedding ring, and a woman from Europe thought it almost immoral for a wife not to wear a wedding ring that signaled her married status. A man from Denmark was pained to even watch British Bible school students play soccer, while the British students shrank from his pipe smoking." In each and every one of those examples, there is no specific verse that speaks to any of those issues. And yet, if we're not cautious, if we're not careful, if we're not walking as living sacrifices, we can look on at any one of those issues and make it something that brings division and discord between us and our brethren. So let's take a look at our text. Let's look at the specific examples that Paul is speaking of here this morning, and we'll, of course, draw them out and make a little bit broader application for us this morning. Again, the heading as to our walk with other Christians, we, number one, all are servants of God. The first four verses, we all are servants of God. Paul writes in verse 1 of Romans 14, "Receive one who is weak in the faith, but not to disputes over doubtful things." The first thing that he says is receive one, and the tensing there says keep on receiving one, and he means to receive one into fellowship. Welcome them into the fellowship. Receive one into fellowship who is weak. So we have believers that are weak believers, and we're going to see in a moment that we have believers that are strong believers. Keep on receiving one into the fellowship who is weak in the faith. Now notice here that it says the faith. It doesn't say weak in faith. It says weak in the faith. They are weak as it relates to doctrine. They're not weak morally. It's not speaking about their sin issue, but they're weak because they still think a person's righteousness depends on them and how they behave. That's what makes them weak. They're weak in the faith. They're weak in the faith, in the doctrine of the truth that we're robed in the righteousness of Christ, that we're declared righteous by Jesus. We can't make ourselves more righteous. David Guzik, he says this, "We should distinguish between someone who is weak and someone who is rebellious. Two very different things. We need to distinguish between those who are weak and those who are rebellious. There are many reasons why a Christian might be weak. They might be a babe in Christ. The babies are weak. Hey, they're brand new in the Lord. They're like my friend in the jail. He's 8 weeks old in the Lord. We had a whole discussion about what day of the week the Bible tells us to worship on. It tells us to worship every day of the week. So we had to work through that. They may be sick or they may be diseased, the weak Christian, because of legalism. Fences and hedges that they've set up around themselves to try and force themselves to walk in some sort of legalistic righteousness. They may be malnourished. They just lack good teaching. Man, it's getting harder and harder these days to find churches that will teach God's word verse by verse, chapter by chapter, line upon line, and actually to teach God's word and not leave out huge chunks. If there's one comment I hear from people today about churches in our community is that, oh, yeah, you know what? It's really great when they teach that particular portion, but then they skip the whole next chapter or they go to a whole nother book and they never deal with this issue. They never deal with that issue. A person may be weak also because they lack exercise. They need somebody in spiritual authority to speak into their life, words of exhortation, pushing them and encouraging them to go deeper in their walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. And so here Paul, Romans 14, 1, he says, keep on receiving into fellowship one who is weak in the faith, but look at this, but not to disputes over doubtful things. Don't receive them into the fellowship so you can straighten them out. Wow. Seriously? Yeah, seriously. And don't bring them into the fellowship so that you can criticize them, so you can argue with them, so you can try to settle them on your particular opinion as to what the truth is as it relates to a situation. Don't do that. Don't even invite them to church for that purpose. You invite people to church for the purpose of knowing Jesus and learning his word. Don't invite them to Jesus because you want to somehow change what you think their behavior is from a poor and weak Christian to some kind of a strong Christian. Don't do that, Paul says. He continues, verse 2, for one person believes he may eat all things. This is the strong person. This is the person who they're strong in their conscience. They're not concerned about what they eat or what they don't eat. But he who is weak in their conscience, they eat only vegetables. So here's what's going on. Again, Paul is writing to Christians in Rome. And the church in Rome was made up of Jews who had gotten born again and come into Christianity, and Gentiles who had been born again and come into Christianity. And here they are, and they're coming together for a pot bless, and they're showing up with all kinds of food to eat. The Jews who have come into Christianity, as they look on at the meat, they go, oh, you know what? I don't want to eat any of that meat. It may have been dedicated to idols. And now the idols can't eat meat, but it may have been dedicated to the idols, and I don't want to touch it. I don't want to eat it. I'm going to steer clear of that because it's been dedicated to idols. The Gentile Christians, they come in and, well, who cares? You know, idols, meat, man, I'm hungry. I'm a meat eater. Let's eat. Doesn't matter to me. I don't care if it's kosher, not kosher. Doesn't matter. Let's eat up. So there was causing conflict within the church. The meat eaters and the vegetarians, because they didn't want to touch the meat that was sacrificed to the idols. Now, Paul says, for one person believes he may eat all things, but he who is weak, weak in conscience, eats only vegetables. They think that they're more spiritual. They think that they're pleasing God in their weakness, because you know what? I don't want to touch that meat because it was offered to an idol. And so the weak brother or sister, as I mentioned, they put up fences. They put up hedges, places where the Bible doesn't say anything about those things. And in a little bit, I'm going to give you a whole list to kind of stimulate our mind to this particular subject. But often, the strict rule followers, they are not the ones who are most mature. The ones who have the rules, they are the ones that are the most immature, according to the scriptures. They're the weak ones. Hey, you shouldn't do that. Hey, you shouldn't do that. Well, wait a minute. The Bible doesn't say anything about that. Yeah, but you shouldn't do that. Okay. They're evidencing themselves to be weak in their faith. Verse 3. Let not him, this is the strong person in their conscience, let not him who eats, and the idea is eats meat, despise him who does not eat. The word despise, it means to throw out as nothing. So there you are going through the pot bless line, and man, you're loading up your plate. You got the barbecue spare ribs. You got the roast beef. You don't care what idol it's been offered to. You don't care if it's kosher or not. Man, you're just piling on the meat. And you see your brother, and he's taking the broccoli and the Brussels sprouts and the zucchini, and you're like, yo, dude, what are you doing? You're missing out on the great pork over here. Oh, you know what? I don't want to take that. That's been offered to idols. Offered to idols. What are you talking about, man? This is good. USDA Prime. Come on, chow down with me. Oh, no, I can't eat that. And here's what you do. In your heart or verbally, you throw him out because he won't eat the way that you eat. Paul says, don't throw him out who does not eat. Just because he's not as strong as you, just because he thinks differently than you, don't toss him aside. And oh my goodness, can we be really good as Christians as tossing people aside, can't we? Ha! We'll kind of sign off on them in our mind or in our heart. Or, you know, we won't say anything directly, but, you know, 5-10 minutes later, we'll go, man, You see Smith over there? You see that big pile of broccoli? Man, what a weak brother. Man, he's missing out. Well, that's great. More meat for me, you know? Don't do that. Don't throw him out. Let not him who eats despise him who does not eat. Look at this, verse 3. And let not him, now this is the weak brother, who does not eat meat, judge, and the word means to criticize, him, the strong brother, who does eat. Oh my goodness, that's a two-way street, isn't it? Here we are at the food table, and the guy taking all the broccoli and not wanting to touch the meat, he's looking on going, dude, man, you're eating that meat. You are headed straight to hell. Straight to hell. You're going to hell because you're eating that meat that was offered to an idol. And he judges his brother. And interestingly enough, I think there's something to it that Paul uses in the first half of verse 3, the word despise, to throw out as nothing. And in the second portion of verse 3, uses the word judge or criticize, because the weak brother, in his criticism, of the strong brother seeks to knock him down, seeks to judge him, seeks to criticize him in his strength to eat whatever is set before him. So, look at verse 3. Let not him who eats despise him who does not eat, and let not him who does not eat judge or criticize him who eats, for God has received him. It's interesting that the Greek tense of the word has received here, it's speaking to the time of his salvation. God, at the time that individual surrendered their life to Christ and was born again, God received him. Whether he eats meat or whether he eats vegetables, God has received him. He belongs to God. He's born again by his Holy Spirit. That's your brother in Christ, that weak believer. That's your brother in Christ, that strong believer. And so what we see here in these first three verses is an exhortation to not try and change the other person. The weak is not to judge the strong, and the strong is not to cast aside the weak. Don't try and change the other person. But here's what I like. I like this phrasing. But see past that person to God. Look on at that individual and recognize they don't belong to me. They belong to God. I'm not seeing the weak brother or sister or the strong brother or sister. I'm seeing God in them, God upon them, them being my brother or sister in Christ. Now, this is something that you're familiar with because there's not a one of you sitting in this room, not a one of you, that when you started attending this church, I sat down with you and went down through a whole list of cultural do's and don'ts. There's not one of you here this morning. Each and every one of you, as you came into this congregation, what did your pastor do? He loved you. He welcomed you. He made sure you had a clean floor to walk on, a comfy chair to sit on. You had a bulletin in your hand. If you didn't come with a Bible, we provided one for you, except for this morning. And so forth and so on. We took care of you. And we've now, if there's sin, we're not talking about sin this morning. We're talking about strong and weak. And this is what a pastor has to do. This is what you want a pastor to do. You don't want a pastor who only loves, who only encourages, and who only ministers to people like him. Because guess what? If I only loved on and ministered to the people that were like me here this morning, do you know who would be here this morning? Just me. Because I don't know if you know it or not, but none of you are like me. None of you. The only thing that you and I have in common, if you're here saved this morning, is if we've been born again by the Holy Spirit of God. That's our commonality. And you are not to make me into your image. And I do resist that quite frequently when I meet with people. And I am not to make you into my image. This is why I teach the Bible and not my life story, because we're all focused on being like Jesus. Okay, I promised you some illustrations that we'd have some clarity and some real-time application to the things that we're talking about. Let me ask you something, Christian. Don't shout out. Don't raise your hand. Is it sinful or ungodly to go to the theater? How about movies? How about alcohol? The Bible is clear. You are not to be drunk. But is it okay to drink alcohol? What about smoking? Now, personally, I think smoking is foolish. I think you're killing yourself. But Charles Spurgeon, a great titan of the church, he smoked like a chimney. And I'm pretty sure he loved Jesus and was saved. The Bible doesn't speak to it. How about playing of cards? Can a Christian play cards? I don't know. I don't know if a Christian can play cards or not. Are you any good? But the Bible doesn't say that you can't play cards. Now, is playing cards and doing some other things a gateway to gambling? Well, yeah, gambling is a sin. And there are some people that make that connection with card playing, but the Bible doesn't say anything about whether you should play cards or not. How about dancing? Again, can a Christian dance? I don't know. I can't dance. I am a Christian. I can't dance, and it has nothing to do with what the Bible says. I just got no rhythm. Sometimes here when we're doing praise and worship, you know, people like to clap along, and I want to clap along too. And And before you know it, I'm so focused on bringing my hands together with some kind of rhythm that's outside of my head that I'm not worshiping any longer, so I stop. Got to have some rhythm if you're going to dance. How about fashion? My two favorite stories. The pastor whose wife came to church one Sunday wearing a bright red pair of high heels and about got driven out of the church because that's the footwear of the devil. That's here in Grand Rapids, by the way. Or how about this? This is from another church here in Grand Rapids, where a woman came to the church looking for a relationship with the Lord Jesus. She met with one of the church leaders after the service, just very informally, at the back of the room. And she said, "Hey, I have a couple questions." And he said to her, "I am not going to answer your questions, and you will never come back to this church dressed like that again." She was wearing a skirt, a dress made out of denim material, out of jean material. "Hey, you can go to Christian music." Christian music, country music, rock and roll music. What music is of the Lord? What does the Bible have to say about that? What about wealth? Are you living in sin and rebellion to God if you have wealth? Do you know some churches believe that? You shouldn't be wealthy if you're a Christian. How about hymns or praise and worship music? Whether we use organs or guitars. How about suits, ties, and dresses, or shorts, flip-flops, in Hawaiian shirts? Which one is more spiritual? Which one does God approve of more? Oh, how about the day of the week that we worship on? Whether Sunday is the Sabbath day, it's not. Saturday is the Sabbath day. Whether what we do on Sunday, are we allowed to go to the beach? Are we allowed to mow our lawn? Hey, who is more spiritual? The person who hugs or the person who gives handshakes? Do you see the things that can divide us and the things we can assess and evaluate is who's the most holy? On my jail visit this week, I was so blessed as our time together came to an end. And my young friend said to me, "You know, I'd like to come visit your church if you come pick me up. You know, that'd be wonderful. But, you know, I'm really concerned about, you know, I don't always talk the best, and I'm kind of shy. And, man, I've really made some serious mistakes in my life. And, you know, and I won't enumerate them here, but he has. And you know, I don't really have very much good clothes to wear and everything. I mean, how is that going to work? I mean, am I going to feel uncomfortable? Am I going to be embarrassed?" And I let him finish. And when it got all done, I waited just a beat. I just let everything just sit there for quiet for just a moment. And then I said, "Well, I'll tell you what. If you come to Calvary Chapel, you can come and worship the Lord with a whole room full of ex-murderers, adulterers, liars, thieves." And I said, "As to dress, I'd appreciate if you wore something. But what you wear, I really don't care. And neither does anybody else. Hey, whether you wear a suit and tie, whether you wear a dress, whether you tuck your shirt in or untuck your shirt, whether you wear shorts. I got a brother here this morning in flip-flops. It was 18 degrees out there this morning. But God bless. You know what? God bless that brother. He's got the sweetest, cutest feet in the entire world. You know what? And we're all getting a chance to see him. And God bless him. That is wonderful for him." Right now he can see me. That's great. Okay. We're all servants of God. So here comes verse 4, because verse 4 is the principle that Paul wants to communicate. Who are you to judge another man's servant? Who are you to judge? In non-essentials to the faith, who are you to judge another's servant? And if you want to write in your Bible right there, it's servant of God. They are not a servant of you. Here's the thing that I've found. If you are busy serving God, you don't have time to judge others. It's not even on your radar. You're so busy about your Father's business, you really don't give a rip what somebody else is wearing. It's not an issue. Now again, Paul here is not speaking about sin. He's not speaking about doctrine that's clearly given in Scripture. In fact, also, Paul is not speaking about requirements that come with serving. "Hey, I want to help out in the children's ministry. I'll be there at 10:15 every Sunday to help." No, children's ministry service starts at 9:30. So you need to be there at 9:30. "Well, who are you to judge me?" Well, I'm not judging you. That's just a requirement of the service. Hey, I want to be a greeter. I'll be there at 11 o'clock. Well, by 11 o'clock, everybody's going to be in and the service is already going to be going. Hey, I want to help out running video ministry. I can be there once a year. Well, no, if you run video ministry, the rotation's every 3 weeks. You need to be there to... It's not that. It's in non-essentials to the faith. Who are you to judge another servant? And verse 4, this next phrase, one of my most favorite verses in the Bible. Probably in the top 5, believe it or not. To his own master, he, the Christian, stands or falls. Man, I love that. I am so not responsible for you or you for me. No, my responsibility comes to make sure that I'm teaching you truth. I have a responsibility that if I see you living in sin, to come and to exhort you and to encourage you and to direct you into a pathway of righteousness. I do have that responsibility. But I don't have a responsibility to call you on Sunday morning and say, hey, now, which tie are you wearing with that shirt? Now, are you doing a dress this morning? Are you doing a skirt? Hey, what are your plans for Sunday afternoon? Don't you mow that lawn. I'm coming by your house to check you. No, I don't know. Before his own master, a servant stands or falls. And what we do as a church, when we make a whole list of rules for people to follow, here's what we're communicating. We don't have faith in God and the work of the Holy Spirit. So what we're going to do is we are going to lay a burden upon God's people. You want to be a part of this church, you keep these rules. The only problem is it's absolutely and totally unbiblical. Totally. Before his own master, a servant stands or falls. This verse right here is how I can sleep at night. Because you know what? You're a servant of the Lord. I'm a servant of the Lord. I ain't your boss. I'm not your God. Oh, man. That takes off a whole lot of pressure. But the better news yet comes. Okay, we're looking at the principle, verse 4. Who are you to judge another servant? To his own master he stands or falls. Indeed, he will be made to stand. By who? The pastor, the elder, the deacons. There are some churches that do that, and it's wrong. No, indeed, he will be made to stand, for God is able to make him stand. The phrase "is able" there, it's an unfortunate translation because it's speaking about God's power. It carries the idea, the word with it, of mighty. Indeed, he will be made to stand, for God is mighty to make him stand. For God has power to make him stand. God has the ability to make the strong brother and the weak brother in the fellowship of faith to make them stand as being useful, as being helpful, as being maturing in their faith and their walk with the Lord. We don't kick the weak people out. We pray for them. And we allow God to make them stand. You know what? Someday they'll grow up. They'll come to an understanding as they sit. And this is why it's so awesome to be under the teaching from the children's ministry on all the way up through adulthood, of verse by verse, line upon line. Because here's what we can count on. If they stick with it long enough, not only being in service, hearing the word taught twice a week, they're involved in prayer, so they're growing spiritually as a believer, but they're also in their own devotional life, we can know they're going to grow and mature. I was blown away. My friend in the jail, it was 17 days since I had seen him. And the growth that took place in those 17 days as he read his Bible. He doesn't have anybody else. He doesn't have anyone. There's nothing else going on. It's just him and his Bible. And the growth was amazing. All right, second section, here we go. Gotta move along. As to our walk with other Christians, number one, we all are servants of God. Number two, we all belong to the Lord, verses 5-9. We all belong to the Lord. Verse 5, one Christian esteems or honors one day above another. So there are some Christians who look at their life and there's 6 secular days in the week and there's 1 sacred day of the week and they call that day Sunday. Another, he esteems every day, and the word alike shouldn't be there. Another esteems every day. There's other believers who look on, and all 7 days in the week, they're all sacred to them. Now, I have to tell you, it's true. Jesus was, in fact, resurrected on a Sunday. And Jesus, he did meet with his disciples on the 2 Sundays following his resurrection. So that's three in a row. The Holy Spirit was given on the day of Pentecost, which was also the birth of the church, which also happened to be on a Sunday. The disciples, we're told later in the book of Acts, gathered to break bread together on the Sunday. And Paul, he told the Corinthian church that when they gathered together on a Sunday to take up a collection, is Sunday special? Yes. Are we obligated to worship on Sunday? Are we obligated to worship on Sunday? Are we obligated to worship on Sunday? No. In fact, if we lose our building, I have no news, but if we lose our building and we have to meet on a Saturday someplace to make it work, how many of you will I lose? Because it's not Sunday. Oh, I hope that's not going to happen. Sunday, it's a privilege to get together and worship. Many of us are blessed that we don't have to work on Sunday. I'm not one of those, but many of you are blessed. You don't have to work on Sunday. So we can come together and we can worship the Lord and we can serve the Lord on Sunday because we're free. But there is no New Testament command to keep the Sabbath or Sunday. And yet we see the principle given in God's word that, you know what? It's advantageous to have one day of rest amongst 6 days of work. So we get that. Interesting. December 5, PJ Media speaks of this these statistics dealing with this. According to a new survey conducted by Lifeway Research, 56% of Protestant churchgoers believe that the Bible commands Christians to take a day of Sabbath rest each week. 19% aren't sure. And 25% agree that it's not commanded in the scriptures. He goes on to write, it's interesting that 33% say that they avoid paid work, yet only 11% say that they avoid shopping. Even assuming that everyone who makes up the 11% is also included in the 30%, that's still a lot of people who believe that they shouldn't work on Sunday, but still engage in activities that require others to work. I never got that. One person esteems one day above another. Another person esteems every day alike. Paul says, let each be fully convinced in his own mind. Hey, based on the foundation of the knowledge that you have as it guards and guides your personal convictions, hey, then that's what you have to do. That's what you have to do. F.B. Meyer writes the following, by thought and prayer and the study of God's word, conscience becomes educated and strengthened and ceases to worry as to whether we should be vegetarian or not, whether we should observe saints' days or adopt a specific method of observing the Sabbath. Some people are constantly wondering and questioning about such things as though their eternal salvation depended on minute observances. Now I gotta tell you something. If God tells you that for you it is wrong, I'll pick a common one, to mow your lawn on Sunday, then you better not mow your lawn on Sunday. But if your Christian neighbor is mowing his lawn on Sunday, the principles here in Romans 14 tell us, let him mow. Don't look down on him. Don't judge him or criticize him because the Bible doesn't say anything about that. And it is true. There are decisions that each and every one to make for us. As a husband, as a father, as the high priest of my household, I make decisions for my family that the scriptures don't have anything to say about. But you know what? I have a conviction within me in my walk before the Lord that, you know what? We're not going to do this. Other people can do it, and God bless them in it if he can, but we're not going to do that. And that those are my personal convictions. Let each be fully convinced in his own mind. Continuing on verse 6. He who observes the day or esteems the day, the the Sabbath day, the Sunday, the day of worship. He who observes the day observes or esteems it to the Lord. Hey, I want to please God. I don't want to mow my lawn on Sunday because I want to just have this day to rest in the Lord and to take the day off from my daily work. That's wonderful. Do that. There have been days over the 19 years I've lived in the neighborhood that I live in, there have been Sunday afternoons where I've had to mow my lawn, especially before I had Junior to help me out with it. It was just me. I got to get the lawn mowed. And so you know what? Rained and hail or whatever's going on, and mow my lawn on Sunday. I have to do it. While I'm doing it, I know I have freedom in Christ to do it. But I also know I'm disturbing my neighbors as maybe they're trying to sleep or they're playing out in the backyard with their friends and their family. You know, I don't like doing it, but there's not a law against it. There's not a law for it. Hey, he who observes the day observes it to the Lord. He who does not observe the day, verse 6, to the Lord, he does not observe it. He believes he's doing the Lord's will one way or the other. Colossians 2, 16 and 17, take note of this. Colossians 2, 16 and 17, let no one judge you in food or in drink, or regarding a festival or a new moon or Sabbath, which are a shadow of things to come, but the substances of Christ. Let no one judge you as it relates to the Sabbath. You be convinced, be settled in your own mind and heart, and let it rest at that. Continuing on. He who eats to the Lord, he gives God thanks. He who does not eat to the Lord, he does not eat and gives God thanks. This is the Christian life. Ephesians 5 tells us that we're to give thanks always for all things to God the Father. We're to have thankful hearts, whether we participate or whether we don't. Hey, I bless God that you eat only vegetables. I praise the Lord that I eat meat. I'm just thankful to the Lord. I'm thankful to God for you. Verse 7. For none of us, Christians, lives to himself, and no one dies to himself. Now, right here, my fellow students of Romans, this should kind of light up your minds and your hearts, because he's speaking to us about us being a body. About us being connected. We saw this in Romans 12. I say through the grace given me to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same function, so we, being many, are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. We are connected to each other. Verse 7, Romans 14, none of us lives to himself. No one dies to himself. We're connected to each other like a body. Verse 8, for if we live, we live to the Lord. Very important to see the word Lord there, because it's speaking of God being our master. If we live, we live to the Lord. As long as I'm living, I'm going to live for my master, Jesus. And you're not my master when it comes to spiritual things. And I'm not yours. Isn't that cool? If we live to the Lord. He's my master. And if we die, well, we die to the Lord. We go to be with our master. I'm dying unto him. And the fact of the matter is, we do not choose when we live or die. What we do is we choose to do all we can do to glorify God while we're alive. I want to glorify God in my life. I want to glorify God in my death, because he is my master. So then here comes the principle. Back half of verse 8, starting with the word therefore. Here comes the principle Paul wants us to have. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. Now, this brings up another verse of mine that is quite a favorite. It comes from John chapter 21, verse 21 and 22. I'll read it to you. John 21, 21 and 22. Peter, as in Peter, James, and John, Peter's speaking to Jesus, and Peter, seeing the disciple John, said to Jesus, but Lord, what about this man? Speaking of John. And Jesus said to him, if I want to make it such that John remains till I come, What is that to you, Peter? You, Peter, follow me. That's your job. John's following me. Peter, you follow me. You focus, Peter, on yourself. You know, I've discovered the more mature, the older I have gotten in the Lord, I have come to see, you know what? My hands are full with me. My focus, my perspective needs to be on the furrow that I'm supposed to be plowing. Because you know what? The world is pulling at me and yanking at me and tearing at me and trying to take me off track. My hands are full. I need to focus on my master as I'm his disciple following him. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, the fact that we are the Lord's, his ownership of us, Christ died, rose, and lived again, that he might be the Lord, the master of both the dead and the living. How incredible is that? So you and I as Christians, we are servants of God. He is our master. He died for us. He rose again for us. He lives again for us. We belong to him. And from Jesus' own mouth, he said, don't worry about him. Let me focus on you. Does that free us up? Does that allow us to just fellowship and to enjoy each other? You bet it does. Third and final point. As to our walk with other Christians, number one, we are all servants of God. Number two, we all belong to the Lord. And here comes number three, these last few verses. We all are not to judge, verses 10 through 13. Verses 10 through 13, Paul writes, why do you judge your brother? Here, why do you, the you, is the weak brother who makes all the rules. This is the rule-making brother. Paul says to him, why do you judge your brother? See, the weak brother, he judges the strong brother, well, as unspiritual, as a compromiser. See, you know what? If you really love the Lord, you'd be a hugger. If you really love the Lord, you'd be a handshaker. If you really love Jesus, you'd wear your shirt untucked. If you really were spiritual, you'd be in a suit and tie. If you really did, you see how that goes? You have to go back and reference all those examples that I gave. If you're really a Christian, you'd listen to country music. Well, I don't know. See, it's the weak brother that judges the strong brother. And what's amazing, Christian, one of the ways that you can determine how you're growing and developing in your Christian walk is you can see these cats coming from a mile away. Oh, my God, their greatest time of shine is a Sunday morning and a Wednesday when they're here in the midst of you because they look good. But you know what I know about them? Apart from this place, their lives are falling apart. They can hardly keep their marriage together. Their kids aren't tracking with them spiritually. Oh, they have got all of the words and the phrases. They have got it down. And man, they look good. But their mouth gives them away. Why do you judge your brother? Why, weak brother? Why are you judging the strong ones around you that have liberty? Or, back half of verse 10, why do you show contempt for your brother? The stronger brother who doesn't live by the rules, why does he show contempt for the weaker brother? The stronger brother, he writes off the weaker brother. Man, you're just uptight. What's wrong with you? You need to get right with Jesus. You need to read your Bible. You need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Then you can be just like me. Oh, God forbid. Don't anyone be just like me. Or like you either. You want to be just like Jesus. So notice Paul, he's hitting both sides here. Why weak brother, are you judging your strong brother? Or why, strong brother, are you showing contempt for your brother? I always like to listen. Hey, is that a strong brother, somebody that's mature in the faith, just knocking down their little brother or their little sister, another peg? Man, is that a sister who knows her Bible and is strong in the things of the word, showing contempt for her little sister who's new in the faith or hasn't advanced yet to the place that she's at? I always like to listen for that, even coming from my own mouth. For, back half of verse 10, for we, Christians, we, the strong and the weak, shall, notice that next word, all. We all, strong and weak, we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Now, this is the Bema judgment seat of Christ. There are three judgment seats given to us in the Bible, and because of the clock, you're not going to get them this morning. So I'm sorry to tell you that. One is the Great White Throne Judgment, Revelation 20. One is the Judgment of the Nations, Matthew 25. This is the Bema judgment. This happens after the rapture of the church. This is the reward stand. This is where we as Christians, both strong and weak, come before the Lord, and we are rewarded for the things that we have done. Well, we're rewarded for all those things that Jesus has done through us. 2 Corinthians 5:10, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, not to judge us for sin, that was done at the cross, but to judge us for rewards. The judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. I need a drink. I ask you to find 1 Corinthians. Turn there with me. The clock's ticking, I'm cruising. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 11. For no foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. There's the foundation. Romans 12, 1, living sacrifice, foundation. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold and silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clear. For the day, the judgment day, the Bema judgment seat, will declare it or reveal it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. What is the quality? What is it made up of? If anyone's work, which he has built on it, endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. This is the Bema judgment seat of Christ. And back in Romans 14, verse 10, scriptures declare, we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. We don't have to sort it out now. Do you notice when you come to church here, there isn't a Sunday, and some churches do this. Do you know there is not a Sunday where you come to church on a certain Sunday of the year, and I have a whole bucket full of gold stars. And if you've perfect attendance for another year, served in children's ministry another year, missions, evangelism, outreach, here you are, gold stars. Some churches do that. They reward pins, they reward gold stars, they reward all sorts of things. No. The rewards aren't now. The rewards are future at the reward stand of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Olympic champions, they're not given, I got to think about it a minute, bronze, silver, and gold before they race. They're given bronze, silver, and gold after they race. And where they're given those rewards is called the Bema. It's from the Greek. That's where the rewards are given. You came in first. You came in second. You came in third. Now here's the great thing. In Christ, y'all won. Everybody came in first. The only issue is what rewards you receive for the things you have done for the Lord here, that you can then take those rewards and cast them back down at his feet. And that's a different teaching, which is available on our website, the issue of rewards and crowns and the beauty of that. The point here, we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, I'm back in Romans 14, Isaiah 45, 23, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, And every tongue shall confess to God. At the end of the day, I'm the Lord. I'm the master. God says, everybody comes before me. I'm the one that takes care of business. So then, verse 12, each of us shall give account. Here's what we got to see. Of himself to God. We're not going to give account for our brother. We're not going to give account for our sister. We're not going to give account for anybody else before ourselves. You don't know the number of people that I have heard say, yeah, well, when I stand before the Lord, I'm going to tell him what a rotter my husband was. No, no, you're not. You're not going to be judged for your husband. You're going to be judged for you. Oh, you know what? When I stand before the Lord, I'm going to tell him about those kids he gave. No, no, no. Oh, when I stand before the Lord, I'll be okay because my wife, she loved. No, your wife, it doesn't matter how much she loved Jesus. Each one of us shall give account of himself to God. Here's the third and final principle we close then with. Verse 13 gives to us the principle. We all are not to judge. Here comes the principle. Verse 13, therefore, let us not. The tense here is let us not, let us no longer have the habit. We have the habit to do this. Let us no longer have the habit to judge or to criticize one another anymore. Do not assume the office of judge over anyone. Let us not judge or criticize one another anymore. And again, the context of this is over those doubtful non-essentials. As Christians, we are to question. We are to offer advice. We are to encourage and we are to exhort. G. Campbell Morgan says this, when I pass judgment on my brother, I am usurping the very throne of God. God alone knows all the facts and God alone is able to pass a judgment. And this right he reserves to himself. The spirit of judgment open to us is not our brother's life and action, but our own. The only one I should be judging is myself. The test by which we are to judge is the welfare of our brother. In areas of sin, in areas where the scripture is clear, 2 Timothy 4:2, convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching. That's what we're supposed to do when there's sin. Areas that are appropriate for rebuke or admonishment, 1 Timothy 5:20, those who are sinning, rebuke in the presence of all that the rest also may fear. Titus 1:13, rebuke them sharply that they may be sound in the faith. Speak these things, Titus 2:15, exhort and rebuke with all authority. Hey, we're not talking about sin this morning. We're talking about the non-essentials. Let us no longer have the habit of judging one another anymore. Okay, so we're not going to do that. What are we supposed to do? Here we close. But rather resolve this, or judge yourself in this. Not to put a stumbling block or a cause to fall in our brother's way. Bottom line, don't hinder another person's spiritual progress. Don't hinder another person's journey. As to our walk with other Christians, be relating in liberty. We're all servants of God. We all belong to the Lord. We all are not to judge. Next week, the back half of chapter 14, we'll be looking at be relating in love. This week, be relating in liberty. Next week, be relating in love. Father, thank you for your word to us this morning through Romans 14. Father, a word of exhortation and communication that we so need to hear and to be reminded of. Father, to truly, in our words today, to live and let live as it relates to the non-essentials in the Christian faith. Father, thank you that where your spirit is, Lord, there's liberty. Father, where your word is silent, Lord, we can seek your face, your guidance, your direction for our lives. Above all, Lord, protect us from hindering or harming another person's spiritual growth, walk, or relationship with you in any way. Father, keep us from judging. Keep us from criticizing. Father, keep us in the place of loving one another and keeping the focus in the light of your word and the ministry of your Holy Spirit and the assessment and the evaluation and the exhortation of your Holy Spirit upon us. Father, if there'd be one within the sound of my voice this morning who's never surrendered their life to you, maybe because they've seen hypocrisy in the church, maybe because they've been the victim of judgmentalism within the church, Lord, I pray this morning, this would be the morning that they would see that's not your heart. That's not the instruction of your word. And Father, they would let those past pains and those past hurts go. And Father, they would rededicate themselves to you. Or maybe this morning, for the first time ever, they would submit and surrender to a Lord and a Master that loves them above and beyond all things, turning from their sin and receiving you, Jesus, as their Lord, their Master, their Savior, and their friend. Father, thank you. That's a prayer that you hear, a prayer that you heed, and you welcome that person into a relationship with you. Father, for the rest of us, Lord, may we not judge one another anymore, but rather resolve this, not to put a stumbling block or a cause to fall in our brother's way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.